I very much hope you enjoyed our evening in the fronton with the Basque sport and the incredible Basque dancing. I hope it gave you an insight into some of the very interesting things people get up to here in Bilbao. So this morning they're giving me some time off, and it's my pleasure to hand you over to the moderator of our morning discussion panel. Nancy Batens is a freelance in communication and management. She delivers training in communication to both public and private bodies in Belgium and beyond. She specializes in stress management, and in her own words, you always have a choice. So here to challenge us a bit today, for I'm told she likes to do this, I hand you over now to Nancy. Thank you, Nancy.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm not going to do a lot of talking immediately. First, we're going to listen to the keynote speaker. So let me quickly introduce you to the panel. So we start with Kris de Meester, who was already here yesterday, chair of the Health and Safety Group of Business Europe, and we even saw him in action dancing and doing pilota. Then we have Mrs. Aïda Ponce de Castillo, senior researcher at the European Trade Union Institute, come from Brussels. Patricia Faro, who is the head of health and safety at the SEAT Group, and she will be sharing information from what they've been doing at SEAT. Sergio Iavicoli, president of the European Academy of Occupational Health Psychology and director of the Department of Occupational and Environmental Medicine, Epidemiology and Hygiene. So this is something I had to read because it was quite a mouthful. And finally, Pam Burrows, who's a professional speaker, managing director at Pam Burrows People Booster, and she worked intensively with Healthy Workplaces, Good Practices Awards winner, Nottingham City Homes. But first, we're going to listen to Professor Johannes Siegrist, who's a senior professor at the Work Stress Research at the Heinrich-Heine University in Düsseldorf, Germany. Welcome.
Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure and honor to be here and to share some recent knowledge from scientific evidence to support and to strengthen measures to reduce psychosocial stress at work, the important aim of this campaign. Now let me start the few moments I share with you with a short reflection on what is the importance of work for health and for well-being. Clearly, as you all know, work provides a source of regular income and related opportunities. It provides a source of personal growth and training of capabilities and competencies. It provides social identity, social status, and related rewards. Work enables access to social networks beyond the family, beyond primary groups. It should also be strengthened that work impacts on personal health and well-being on the positive side by providing resources, but on the negative side by exposing people to material and psychosocial stressors. Now, many of us are fortunate to stay at work, but you know, we have a huge problem across Europe in terms of unemployment and underemployment. As you can see here, about 20 million people are unemployed beyond the age of 25, and more than 5 million people are unemployed under the age of 25. And almost 10 million of workers are forced to work part-time, although they would need a full-time position. That's why a couple, 2 years ago, actually, we sit together to to make a declaration of Santiago de Compostela and a conference on economy, stress, and health to raise the awareness among policymakers to do something to increase this or to reduce the threat and to increase measures to reduce unemployment and underemployment. Because, as you can see here, long-term unemployment really has a negative impact on health. It is a risk factor of elevated morbidity and mortality from a variety of disorders. Now, talking about work is not possible without having a look at significant changes in the nature of work and employment. And I mentioned just a few ones here. What we see is an increase in the service sector, in administrative jobs, in IT jobs, including human service professions with a high psychomental and emotional workload. Many jobs require high flexibility, mobility, and adaptation to new tasks, to new technologies. And there's an increase of work pressure due to competitive labor market, shortage of employment, and downsizing of personnel. Furthermore, we see a fragmentation of occupational careers. Many people talk about a de-standardization or a growth of atypical work and growing in job instability and insecurity. And finally, what we see is a segmentation of the labor market into highly qualified and unqualified population groups. And this means that we see an increase in the social inequalities in the quality of work and employment. Some of these developments have to do with the effects of economic globalization, in particular with labor market consequences in high-income countries, as such in the European Union. In general, there's an increased pressure of rationalization due to wage competition, and the consequences are mainly downsizing, merging, and outsourcing as the effects, which then results in a worse work intensification, in an increase in job security, and also in some problems with wage and salary, adequate and fair payment of the work. But is this true? Do we really observe an increase? And you can see this is a recent analysis of an increase in work intensity between 2004 and 2010 based on the European Social Survey in 19 EU countries. And just have a quick look at these two bars. Yellow is 2004 and blue is 2010. And whatever you look at, whether the continental or the southern or the eastern part, you see an increase in the mean intensity of work between these two measurement points. And likely, the same holds true for job insecurity. Again, 2004, 2010, European Social Survey, 19 EU countries. Here, blue is 2004, yellow is 2010, and you see whatever subpopulation you look at, a steep increase in job insecurity across these populations. And in particular, these, the light yellow, these are temporary workers, and in the in these temporary workers, the job insecurity has increased most markedly. Now, what does it mean in terms of health consequences? And I'll just give you two examples. One important consequence of work intensity, of course, is an increase in overtime work. And there have been several studies in analyzing overtime work and its effect on depression, for instance, on coronary heart disease. And you can see HR means the hazard ratio. And that means if those who have normal work hours have a hazard ratio of 1.0, those who work for more than 11 hours over years, they have more than twice that risk, 2.4 times elevated risk of severe depression and also of coronary heart disease. And an interesting study from Finland has analyzed those consequences of people who survive, in a way, the downsizing, who remain in a company which did downsizing. These people, they have an increase of work pressure and also an increase of job insecurity. And you can see, again, an increase of the risk even of mortality. This is a most recent example from a large city, from a large study which involved more than 600,000 working people from 24 cohorts across the globe, in a way. And it has been published a couple of weeks ago in The Lancet. What we did here is to summarize the evidence, in particular on stroke. Stroke is fortunately a rare event, so you need many people to have a convincing answer. And you can see there's a nice dose-response relationship. The more hours people work, the higher the risk of getting a stroke in the long term. Of course, if you are an artist and you work for 60, 70 hours, that may be wonderful because you are creative. But if you are forced to work, and if you are exposed to stressful work, then these long working hours are important. And that means that psychosocial stress at work is a more complex issue than just looking at working hours. And what we need, actually, is a theoretical model, a model which identifies those components within the complex work environments which really matter for health and well-being. And there are several such theoretical models, but three have received most attention in the research of the last 20 years or so. And the first one on the left-hand side is the well-known job demand control model, which focuses on task profile. And according to this model, it's just the combination of high work pressure, high demands on your job, in combination with little control, little opportunities to decide, to have a decision latitude. And this toxic component, this is the essence of this demand control model, which was developed by Bob Karasek 30 years ago. The second model is termed effort-reward imbalance, and this is a model which has been developed in our group, and we focus on the employment conditions, on the contract of work, where there is basically a reciprocity. You give something by working, by providing your competences, but you receive in return some rewards. And if there's an imbalance between high effort and low reward, then this is stress. And we do not look only at money, we also look at status, which means job security, job promotion. And we look at the non-material component of reward in terms of esteem, recognition, appreciation. And the third model is organizational justice. This has to do with fair procedures, lack of harassment, distributive justice, and so on. Now, these are the two or the three main health outcomes which have been studied by these theoretical models. This is depression, this is coronary heart disease, and also musculoskeletal disorders. However, the evidence is strongest in terms of depression and coronary heart disease, and these are the two conditions which worldwide have a major impact, not only on life expectancy, but also on disability-free life years. So it's really important to study these conditions. Okay, so these are the three models: demand control with a focus on job task profile, effort-reward imbalance with a focus on the work contract, high effort, low reward, and organizational injustice with a focus on unfair procedures and interactions. What is the evidence? Because often employers say, well, tell me, is there sound evidence? Is there hard evidence and to do something in order to improve workers' health? And the strongest evidence comes from longitudinal studies, where you start with healthy cohorts and then you measure the exposure in terms of work stress and you follow up these people and you see, is there an elevated risk to, for instance, to be hit by coronary heart disease if you have a high level of job strain, which is here the demand control model. And you can see this is the most recent summary of the evidence. Overall, it's about the 30% relative risk increase of coronary heart disease if you do a job like high demand, low control, for instance, air traffic controller or many other jobs. Now, 30% increase, is this much or is this little? It is little if you talk about the strength of the increase, but it is much if you think that every fifth working person across Europe is suffering from work stress in terms of these three models. Every fifth worker in Europe suffers from this kind of work psychosocial stress at work. And now if you think 30% increase of relative risk among these millions of employees, then it becomes evident, yeah, it is important. People often don't believe that statistics can improve anything. So you have to go into more detail. You have to show that the development of the disease is also related to work stress. This is an example from a Finnish study with the increase of atherosclerosis. We are all suffering from an increase in atherosclerosis along the life course. But you see, there's one group of workers with a rapid increase of the atherosclerosis in the carotids here in a four-year time period. And this is exactly the group suffering from high effort and low reward here in terms of economic rewards at work. You can even go further. You can monitor with 24 hours ambulatory monitoring what does your organism if you are stressed. And one opportunity is to monitor heart rate and blood pressure. And this is from a study showing that people working with a low level of control at their workplace, they have an increased systolic and diastolic blood pressure over the working day, from morning, mid to the afternoon and evening. And this is significantly different from those with a high level of work-life control. Now, the other condition is depression. And I think this is really strong evidence, which I computed for today's lecture. And you can see there are about 12 studies testing the demand control model, 10 studies testing the effort-reward imbalance model, and 11 studies testing the organizational model. So more than 30 studies, all are prospective, all start with healthy people, and all show overall that we see a double of risk, 100% increase of relative risk of becoming depressed after exposure to these stressful conditions. So this is substantial in terms of public occupational health. This is substantial information. Just one example before I come to the practical implications. This is a study from Finland, and it shows that those with the highest score in work stress in terms of high effort and low reward, they have an increased risk of suffering from a disability pension due to depression. And this is tragic because depression often starts with 30, 40 years. So people are disabled all when they are in their midlife conditions often. And this is a challenge for healthy work campaigns. Now, often we are criticized by people who don't believe that there is a need to act. We are criticized because they say, you don't have randomized controlled trials. You don't have the solid gold standard of evidence to show that if you reduce stress, that then you have an improved health. Now, of course, we cannot do a randomized controlled study in a company. This is ethically and practically impossible. But there's a nice example coming from a French study here, from the Gazelle study in France. And we had the opportunity to monitor the mental fatigue and depression as a function of the time level when you leave, when you go into pension, into retirement. And in France, this was a very flexible retirement. So some people could retire at 55 and others at 65. But importantly, you can see it's always the year of retirement of people, when whatever age, the year of entitlement, where you have a huge reduction in the mental workload in depression. So it's an increase of mental health exactly in the time around the year of retirement. And this increase of mental health, this reduction of depression, this has been caused mainly by those who suffered most from work stress before. Now, I would like to conclude my presentation with a few remarks on the policy implications of the research, which I could only show in a few examples to you this morning. Create more good and healthy jobs. What is needed? We need to reduce occupational hazards and injuries, evidently, it's clear. We need to protect people from discrimination and violence. We need to increase decision-making in task performance and work schedules. We also need to improve the working conditions with options of skill discretion and learning and promotion of personal developments. What is needed is fair pay, recognition, and also a kind of leadership style, which is now called transformational leadership. Increase in participation in relevant information and communication, strengthening the social capital. Promotion prospects according to qualification and continued training. And of course, which is also important, reconciliation of work and family private life. If you have a look across Europe, we see huge differences in the quality of stress at work, in the quality, in the extent of stress at work, in the quality of work. Look, these are means of estimates based on these two models, the effort-reward imbalance model and the demand control here, the low control dimension, which I mentioned. And you see the mean levels of elderly people, which we have analyzed across a number of European countries. And you can see these four here, they do very well. Employees in Switzerland, Sweden, Netherlands, and Denmark, because they have rather low levels of stress in terms of this model. And similarly, these countries here, in terms of control. But look at Italy, Poland, Czechia, Portugal, Hungary. These, and also Spain to some extent, these are countries which, where the mean level of work stress still is very, very high. So there are differential challenges according to the level of work stress. We have essentially three levels to intervene. Of course, we have the personal level to do stress prevention, which is useful, but which has a limited impact because it is just a personal intervention. Then there is the interpersonal level with strengthening leadership, strengthening communication skills, improving collaboration, communication, teamwork, and so on. Again, it is important, but it's restricted. And then we have the structural level where organizational development matters most. And here, the work stress models, which I presented some minutes ago, can give some guidance on how we should target the critical components at organizational level. I will not go into details, but you can see that job enrichment, skill utilization, teamwork, support, recognition, fair wage, gain sharing, qualification, promotion, these are all measures which are consonant with the theoretical models which I presented. Last year, we did a literature search on randomized controlled trials which have been done at work. So this is the highest class of scientific evidence, a randomized controlled trial. And you can see we saw a couple of studies which were conducted to reduce overweight, to improve fruit and vegetable nutrition, to deal with musculoskeletal disorders, and also to do some stress reduction program. Now you see these two bars, black and gray. And the black bars, they represent studies which were conducted in blue colors, in lower skilled people, and the gray shadows, these are studies in white colors. And what you can see, without going into details, many more studies randomized control studies have been conducted in white-collar jobs than in blue-collar jobs. And in a way, this is not consequent because the workload is much higher in blue-collar workers. Okay, so there is evidence, as I have shown, and we are motivated to putting research evidence into practice. And I think the campaign of OSHA is a very important example of putting evidence into practice. So we need to disseminate scientific evidence. We need to establish a business case of investment into good work. And the recent literature review from the US has shown that the average return on investment was $3 for every dollar spent on worksite health promotion programs. Of course, you need a certain time. You need 3 years to wait until this return comes into practice. And small businesses often don't have the time to wait for 3 years to get this return. But there is good evidence that there is a business case for this kind of investments. And then, as I said, promote and disseminate models of good practice. We are facing aging populations, older working forces. And that also means many, many more people are suffering from chronic disease at work or even from disability at work. So therefore, secondary prevention measures are important as well. Monitoring and treating employees with chronic disease disability. And importantly, there is need to have a good access to and quality of treatment, to have therapeutic teams, and to establish models of outpatient settings with continuous support. Return to work is a most important issue. Early return to work, stepwise reintegration, supported employment programs, and relapse prevention. These are very important challenges. Policies of inclusion, of social participation, and appropriate job availability for disabled people are of high need. I think it is good that many employers are now convinced to do something within their company, and trade unions, they are fighting for more healthy work. That's all very important. But we need, in times of economic globalization, we need even more pervasive measures. For instance, we need to apply legal frameworks nationally and internationally. We need to monitor the working conditions, and there are some good examples we heard yesterday, for instance, from Denmark and from other countries, how important a good monitoring is. We need to enforce fair work standards in trade contracts. We need to promote voluntary agreements between employers and trade unions. You cannot do everything by legal and acting. You need voluntary agreements as well. And we need also the support from social movements. And there are good examples at the EU level, such as the corporate social responsibility movement. However, and that's why I put this in red color, what is most important is to maintain and to develop distinct national labor and social policies. We need welfare regimes securing basic social and economic protection, access to healthcare, to further education, in particular in times of neoliberal policies. And this is a final slide where I will show how important this is. What we did here, this is again from a European comparative study called SHARE, Survey of Health, Aging and Retirement in Europe. And what we did here, we had a summary measure of work stress for each country, for participants from each country. So we have here all older employees who participated in the SHARE from Italy, from Greece, Spain, and so on. And here, what you see here is an OECD index of integration policies. How many measures does a country take into account when developing measures to integrate people into the labor market? And this is an index. The higher the number is, the more a country does in terms of integration policies, active labor market policies. And you can see this is a straight linear relationship. the more a country invests into active labor market, integrative labor market policies, the lower the level of work stress in these countries. And the less a country does, like Poland, Italy, Greece, Spain, Czechia, the higher the level of stressful work. Of course, this is not a causation, but it shows that it is really important to extend the interventions beyond the company level and to include national labor and social policies. Dear colleagues, given solid research evidence on adverse health effects of poor work and employment conditions, efforts are needed to reduce the science policy gap by creating more good and healthy jobs, by strengthening labor and social policies at the national and at the EU level. I know several countries are really active, so they should do better. Some are just doing something, they should do more, and some are still passive and they should do something. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, very interesting. Now, before we go on, you've been sitting here, you've had already possibly a late night. I would like everybody to stand up. Everybody, also here. Up. You knew I was gonna be provocative. Okay. Now, as you know, probably know, public speaking is very much linked to stress management, talking about stress here. An exercise I gave years ago in the public speaking courses, and I still give in the stress management courses, I would like to do it with you. So when we're stressed, like for instance, you have 300 people in front of you, your body goes into the you know that, I call that thing, which is basically the sympathetic part of the autonomous nervous system. When you go into the, you can't think very well. So you have to go back into the, how do we do this? Breathing. Now you're probably all breathing at the moment, I hope so. However, possibly not to get into the, so when we're stressed, where do we breathe? Here. What do we need to do? Abdominal breathing. So hold your own belly, your own one, if not it's harassment. And we're going to breathe. And when we breathe in, your lungs are going to fill, usually. You're not allowed to do this, the chest. Now, the lungs need to go somewhere. They can't go to the back. There's your spine. They can't go there. So they'll go down and they'll push your diaphragm, which is going to push the belly out. Don't worry, everything stays in. So what we're going to do, we're going to breathe in. And when you breathe in, the belly goes out. Okay, so follow me. Breathe in. Belly goes out. Breathe out. Belly goes in. Can we all do this? Yeah. Now we're going to make it a bit harder, and then we have a technique completely here, just for you, for free. It's called the 4-4-4-4, and we do this three times. And what is 4-4-4-4? We breathe in, counting to four. We hold our breath, counting to four. We breathe out, counting to four. And you do nothing, counting to four. And I promise you, you won't drop dead or anything. You can do that, counting to four and not do anything. And we do everything three times. So I do it once, and then you'll all join me. Okay, let's do the breathing movement. Okay, so I start. Nothing. And join me, yes? last time. And you can sit down. Voila. For free, the 4444. Now, not that we needed this after the speech of Professor Siegrist, but just to have something to get you moving. But what we would like to do now is come back basically to what he said. So as he said, there is definitely an impact from work intensification, job insecurity, low wages on people's health. And basically what we want to do is, what can we do to change something in the workplace to make it a healthier place? So I have here a panel with, and they all have a vast experience in this domain. And I would like to be as practical as possible with some questions. Some I will ask individually. Sometimes they can also say, okay, I would like to jump in. And there will also be some time for you to ask some questions if you would like. All this within 50 minutes. We can do this. So, Dr. Suk, she works at SEAD. They had this very extensive program, and they conducted a psychosocial risk assessment. Could you tell us a bit more about that and how it went about? Normally, they should.
Good morning. Okay, thank you. Well, yes, I'm the responsible for health and safety in SEAD. I suppose everybody knows, but just in case, we are our main plant is in Martorell beside Barcelona. That means we are in Spain. That means that, unfortunately, we have a very high ratio of unemployment, as Dr. Professor Sigrid said. But luckily, in our company, despite this situation in Spain, in the last years, we have increased our contractations. What that means, now we have 14,000 workers, and these 14,000 workers are quite young, quite healthy, and that's good for us, quite happy. But despite that, we really have problems. Our second cause of the sick leaves, health sick leaves, are because of psychological problems. That's our reality, so we have to go to this. And what we are doing in the practical, we have a very big medical department, and we are helping everybody when they have stress or other psychological problems, because we have physician, psychologist, and also psychiatrist helping them. But what we want to do is to focus all our energy in the prevention. Why? Because now, as I told you, we have a quite good situation, but the future probably is going to be worse, so we have to work a lot now for the future. What we did is starting with an ambitious and a huge project, which is to do the psychological risk assessment of all the workplaces in SEAD. That means 14,000 workplaces. That's difficult. So our project started 1 year ago. We have just finished the first part, which is to have all this information. We use a questionnaire to do it, because it's the only way. This questionnaire is 120 questions for all the workers. And from the first day, we work together with the unions, of course. That's very important for the successful of these programs, because they really help us very much to open the workers to come to us and explain what happens. That's very important. And also with the Catalan government, because the Catalan government also help us, like assistance to, that's the correct questionnaire, for example, and other things that they have all experienced in other companies. So we started 1 year ago. We do it this questionnaire at the same time that we did the medical checkup, because we offer a medical checkup every year to all the workers. And it was very successful. 75% of the workers answer this questionnaire. And now we have the first results. We have a photo where we have the problems. Now we know that we have 20 psychosocial risks in our workplaces. 5 of these psychosocial risks are in red. That means we have to act as soon as possible. This second step is where we are now. We are working on it with all the management of SEAD, not only the medical department or the prevention department, the unions, of course, and then also all the management. Because I have no time here to explain the whole results, of course, but it's interesting to say that, yes, the blue colors are the worst situated in this panel. So we have to work with production area, with the managers of production area, in order to find the best tools to offer to our workers to prevent for the future. No? And that's in our point. Maybe next year I can come to explain the results. We are working very hard. And okay, my conclusion is just suggest everybody, if you can do it, it's a really good experience. And it helps to focus our resources in a properly way to find some solutions. No? And of course, that very important to work with the unions, because if not, you cannot achieve.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. So, so as you said, that is very important to include the workers' representatives. Mrs. Ponce, could you add something to that? Like, have you seen the same thing, and why is it so important?
Making an intervention, I would like to ask Patricia, what was the actual intervention of the unions, if you can just briefly...
Yes, of course. From, as I told you, from the beginning, we have four different types of union in SEAT, because Spain is, I think, it's not all the countries. We introduced the fourth in our meetings in order to look for the most important thing is the questionnaire. So we have to agree with this questionnaire. And then we have regular meetings to go how it's going and how we take all this information. Now they have the results, of course. It's completely transparent from the beginning. And with these results, we are now also working together in order to find some tools that they agree.
Right. So thank you very much. And as Professor Siegrist said, mentioned, it's very important to put research evidence into the discussion of the table, but also this research evidence that can come from different sources. And one source of evidence which is also very much valuable is the knowledge of the worker and the knowledge and expertise of those who are carrying out those jobs, who probably know a little bit more than a manager or more in a different way than a researcher or a labor inspector, because they are hands in. And this knowledge belongs to workers themselves or safety reps. So here is very important to involve the safety reps into the discussions. As Patricia just mentioned, not only by having them as a tool to communicate what is possible to do in the company, but also as a way to extract from them what they can bring with their knowledge and expertise to the design of the questions. How can they be better elaborated, and accompany all this through the risk assessment, bringing in their knowledge and the implementation of the possible prevention measures. So this is how, in practical terms, of safety reps can actually be involved in a better prevention of the company.
Thank you very much. So basically, using their knowledge, for me, is also a way of recognition, like they know, let's use their knowledge. Now, once the assessment has been done, obviously something needs to be put into practice. And for this, I would like to go to Pam Burrows, who worked successfully together with Nottingham City Homes, who won an award. So how did you go about there, Pam?
There were various parts to the strategy, but started with a staff survey. So how stressed did staff feel? What did they feel was missing? Where were the problems? And then along with City Homes, we developed policies and procedures specifically around stress. So obviously they had health and safety policies and procedures and lots of other things in place. But specifically, what do we do about stress, with a flow chart and procedure for people to follow. That followed up with workshops, so managers were all clear about what they needed to do if they were concerned about staff. And then workshops for staff, which were about practical techniques that they could use, and also knowledge of the procedure to know that they were backed up. Because I think for me there's two really important parts of how we deal with stress. And the first is structural, about the organisation. And this was very much about changing the culture so that everything was in place. And then also staff individually understanding what they could have control over directly. So how they could use breathing techniques and mindfulness techniques and other things that I taught them, which was about what they could do on a day-to-day basis. But for me, that had to join up with what the company was doing. And indeed, because we had all the different facets to it, it meant that the actual culture began to change. Everybody was speaking differently about being stressed. And we spoke yesterday a little bit about the stigma of saying, I've got a mental health issue. And I think that started to shift because it was about saying, we all experience stress at some time, and here's what we can do about it. And there was an acknowledgement of that. And this was in a difficult time. There were redundancies, there were budget cuts. And so it wasn't about, you know, everything's rosy and it's all going to be fine. It was, okay, this is tough stuff. We can't change that. But what can we change day to day in how we deal with it?
So basically, what's under our control, what's not under our control, and what shall we do with it? Okay, thank you. Kris, the Meester, do you have something to add to that, like certain practices that can be put into place?
Thank you, good morning. I think already yesterday in my opening speech I gave some indications of where I think the action should be. But allow me maybe to say something about the business case. In Belgium, now 1.5 years ago in our National Labour Council, when we were discussing these whole psychosocial issues and the European Stress Management Campaign, we started off by inviting a series of, let's say, high-level people in this field. And the first one, and we were convinced, I mean the social partners, employers and trade unions, we were convinced we need a strong business case. Then this professor came and said, no, you don't need a business case, forget the business case, because you cannot, with your arguments, you will never be able to convince management and the board of companies to take action. You have to feed them, you have to ask them the right questions in order for them to find out what their business case is and what they have to do. But if you come with studies like this and this presentation in a governing board of a company, they will just move on to the next agenda item. This is not really convincing them. So we need all this evidence, and we are in a room full of people who are convinced. But it was already said yesterday, we are the OSH people. We have no or little impact. So don't come with this kind of story. Trigger them, ask them the right questions. We know in which direction we want to go. It was all said here, but don't think you can convince them with this. There is another element. It was a study, I think, from University of Utrecht. Workers about their work situation, they will believe on their own, they only trust their own judgment. You can come with all of this. The manager can say what he wants. They will trust only their own judgment when it comes to their working situation. So there goes your business case. So why not immediately move to their actual working situation and start working on the things I mentioned yesterday, job crafting, using their capacities, allowing them to develop new competencies, give them some autonomy to work where, when, and how they want. Forget time as a measurement, start focusing on their real work situation.
So basically, don't go there, try and convince them because you might meet resistance, but kind of coach them into where you want them to go. Yeah. Okay. After more than 10 years of European framework agreement on work-related stress, what do you believe is the real impact throughout the European member states, and which have been the key elements that really worked? Dr. Iavicoli.
We heard before from Professor Siegrist some studies they are making, some evaluation in different member states on the impact. But also we had also some policy assessment, like the European Parliament in 2013 made an evaluation of the agreement impact. What is true that we have different level of action, but I think the most successful stories are the one they are making into how the company is working, and I think this is pretty much in line with what Kris was saying. So what is the function of a company and the empowerment in making more productive, which it goes together in making more healthy. And the other point I think it's really has been working is treating this risk as the other risk. So empowering that infrastructure that the Directive 391 created in the risk management. So as was said before, the workers' input, the safety representative role, the employer's role, and the other experts that are empowered to manage and to give their contribution in a participative way using models that have been structured since the 70s, what was mentioned before in those structural intervention of work-related stress model that Professor Siegrist was mentioning before. I think that's the most successful stories. And I think, for instance, Essener is giving, after 5 years, some indication of some of the most successful stories they are going in this direction.
Professor Siegrist, you would like to add something to that? Yes.
Can I just come back to what you said about your employers and the high-level people who are actually, in my view, ignorant? I'm sorry to say that, but you know, if we wouldn't have the scientific evidence that asbestos creates carcinoma, we would never have a ban of asbestos. So to ignore scientific evidence and just to say, I rely only on what my employees tell me and I can forget about scientific evidence, this is ignorance. This is not the way how future-oriented employers can invest into healthy work. And I would say even, we know we are in a crisis with our private economic system worldwide. And we need employers who really care for values such as the health of working people. So, and for this, we need scientific evidence, of course.
Yeah. Kris, I think you're dying to say something. Go, go.
That is not what I was saying. Yeah. What I was saying is that your evidence, which nobody contests, is not the trigger to get them to action. It's not how you make a strong business case with presenting this. And also, if you're OSH people and you start talking about we have to create more good and healthy jobs, then, sorry, the meeting is over already. We are not the ones who are creating jobs. We have to bring our story, the evidence, we need the evidence, and we are all, in this room, we are all convinced we have to take action. What I was trying to say is, how do you now pass on that message, or how do you trigger the companies and also the workers in companies? How do we trigger them to move into this model where you take action on their actual working situation? We need another kind of approach.
Anybody else wants to chip in? Yeah.
I did some work with Experian, and it's kind of right at the heart of this conversation, where the HR director decided the whole HR department were going to have well-being training, and people were very suspicious of it. The thing that happened on the day was they said, oh, it's for us. This isn't something that is about do my job better, learn this procedure. This is about how do I feel each and every day. This is something I can use outside of work, with my family, with my own well-being. And I think that's one of the things that it's helpful in terms of what Kris is saying about how do you get people convinced. Well, it's when they realise it's actually something that's for each one of us, not for the better of the company. And I think if people realise that, and if it truly is something that they can take away like a gift and use it for themselves, then I think that's more convincing than this is for the good of the company.
Thank you. I had a similar experience not so long ago. A unit, a very big unit of 70 people had to go to, no, the head of unit decided, let's all do stress management, because we have a stressful unit. But it was not communicated that well, okay? So I have four groups of 15, 18 people. You do the tour de table, so while you're here, your biggest stressors. I'm not stressed, but my boss says I have to come here, you know? apparently they want something. And then it took them, let's say, half a day, and they said, like, oh, well, actually, I did learn something, and it can be useful. But if it's not communicated well, if they don't see the bigger picture, there might be resistance indeed, I think. Okay. Are there any, before we go to something that everybody's going to answer again, are there any specific questions from the audience that you would like to have answered? Is there a microphone? There.
Thank you very much. My name is Natalie Lotzmann. I'm heading health and safety globally at SAP. And I would like to congratulate you to this panel. I think it was very, very interesting, and I was fascinated, especially by the discussion lately. And I would like to back up what Kris de Meester said very much. So it's not a question, it's more a trying to combine both what Kris de Meester and Johannes Siegrist said. And from a company perspective, yes, they won't do anything, they won't move if it's not talking in their language. And we must definitely understand this, what drives them in the end. So it's not research itself, but you can do both. You can actually, in a very powerful way, combine both things. And I would like to share with you what we've done at SAP several years ago. We have designed an index that is called Business Health Culture Index. So we measure that with the impact of employee surveys. And then we have tried to find some external people they accept on the top management level. In our case, it was PricewaterhouseCoopers. And we worked with them and did on a scientific basis, tried to track down every element of this index to financial outcomes in the end. So it was a very complex process. It was worth it. In the end, we could actually prove that an increase of 1% point of this healthy culture index was impacting financial outcomes, profits in the end, by 70 million euros. 1% point. So we could actually make the case, and that is the combination. And I must say, since then, it's on the radar. Since then, it was not before. It was evidence before, of course, but not so. This was an impact. And I'm very convinced that combining both elements, finding the right language that the C-level talks, but with the means also of science, but not only, that would do it in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Somebody else?
Thank you. My name is Michael Ertel from Bauer in Berlin, Germany. I have a question to Patricia. I think what you're doing at SEAT is very promising. I think it's for the ISTAS 21, is it right? The questionnaire. My question is, you said the participation rate in the staff survey was 75%. This is really very high. So it may mean that the employees have high expectations. What will follow? And my question is, how will you, let's say, guarantee that having done the risk assessment, so just the first step, what will you do that really measures will be developed and implemented to counteract the risks that you've assessed in the first step? So how will the process continue?
Well, the success of this, of course, is according to the participation of the people. If you cannot ask people, you have not the information. You can really don't know exactly what is happening. Fortunately, we have a very high ratio of participation. That is because two reasons. First of all, I tell the representatives of the workers were helping us, so that's very important. And the second one is because we have a tradition in our company that the people comes to the medical department and they trust in us. They come every year. So with this information, and now we have this picture, now we are working together again. If we are experts, of course, the scientific, I'm a physician, so for me the scientific evidence is very important and I use it. But in this field of psychosocial things, we have to talk much more. Because it's not easy, it's a quite different part. And then talking with the representatives of the unions, hearing it, we and also with the managers. They are working also in the Berg, no, with the people. Then with all this, at the moment we have three tools that we really hope that it's going to work. This is for training tools for management from white collar and also for the blue collar. That's the main thing, and we have other ones. What we are going to do now is to introduce these tools for the next year, year and a half, and then we are going to repeat this risk assessment. And we have to be able to prove that it works in order to reducing these red ratios. That's our idea to how to manage that.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yep.
No, first there, yeah. Yeah, yeah, next.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much for organizing this session, for a paper that was presented by Professor Siegrist and discussion of all of you. I'm from Poland, from Central Institute for Labor Protection, and as you mentioned in your presentation, Poland is on the highest level of stress. And we recognize it. It is, agree with this diagnosis. But we do some research in our country, and I think that it's important to look not only general, but look at separate part of society. It's changed with age of people, and it's changed with gender of people. For example, the highest level of stress we recognize in the group of very young women, between 20 and 30 years. So it is moment when they have a lot of duties in occupational, professional life and private life and children, and after it's going better, and the next mountains we found about 50 years. So our tools for intervention must be differentiation between different group address for successful this. Thank you.
Thank you for the specification. The lady there, yeah.
Sí, egunon. Me llamo Carmen y pertenezco al sindicato de enfermería. Entonces, bueno, me he sentido aludida cuando se hablaba del tema de los agentes sociales. Les voy a hacer un estudio de caso, voy a ser muy breve. Nosotros, en el Servicio Vasco de Salud, somos 28.000 trabajadores. 9.000 somos enfermeras y enfermeros. No tenemos ni un solo psicólogo ni un solo psiquiatra. A día de hoy no se ha hecho ninguna evaluación de riesgos psicosociales en nuestra empresa y ustedes saben que las enfermeras y enfermeros sufrimos mucho estrés. Pero no solo eso, sino que ayer tuve que escuchar que nuestros representantes decían que estaban preocupados con el tema. Nosotros les decimos que no se preocupen tanto, que se ocupen del tema. Todos los sindicatos a la una gritamos cada día delante de nuestros hospitales: nos quitan la salud, nos quitan la cultura, esto es una dictadura. Estamos soportando recortes de plantilla, no nos cubren las bajas, nuestra gente está desesperada. Este es un estudio de caso. La semana pasada, en un quirófano de alta complejidad, el quirófano de neurocirugía de un hospital que lo tenemos ahí cerquita, el Hospital de Cruces, me llamaron las enfermeras porque ya no podían más. Me llamaron como delegada de prevención para contarme lo que les estaba pasando. No hace falta ser una experta para ver cómo estaban. Les faltaba de todo. No sabían cuándo entraban a trabajar a las 8 de la mañana y nunca sabían cuándo salían. Respeto al horario, eso no existe. Tenían una supervisora que les estaba machacando día a día, que les gritaba cuando entraba al quirófano, delante de los estudiantes de medicina, delante de los neurocirujanos. Había un anestesista que decía: lo que dice la enfermera va a la papelera. ¿Les puedo contar más? Automáticamente vi en muchas de las personas que estaban mal, pero ¿cómo os podéis acostumbrar a que os humillen en el trabajo? Sacar la cabeza, os estáis acostumbrando a esto, estáis enfermando porque no os estáis dando cuenta. Ahora mismo llamar al servicio de prevención e ir a contar lo que os está pasando. Sois enfermeras, tenéis que saber que estáis enfermando. Automáticamente, efectivamente, se fueron y han pedido cita en el servicio de prevención. Yo como delegada he solicitado en muchísimas unidades de mi hospital que se ponga inmediatamente ya no una evaluación de riesgos. ¿Para qué? Si la gente va y lo cuenta. No, que se intervenga. Ya. La gente pasa a contar lo que le ocurre y el servicio de prevención, porque depende directamente de la organización de recursos humanos, no hace nada porque no le dejan. Son muy buenos técnicos, pero como no hay una voluntad de la dirección, no hacen nada. Y por favor, les pido ayuda a ustedes para decirnos qué tenemos que hacer más los representantes de los trabajadores. Muchas gracias.
Of course, we're very sorry to hear this. Aïda, do you have something to say? Possibly also somebody else afterwards?
Yeah. Absolutely. And I'm very sorry to hear the story of the nurses, but I'm also very glad that you put it in evidence, because indeed nurses, the sector of the nurses is just a tipping point of the iceberg. It's a sector where it's obviously the majority of the workers are women. Women is also a the gender dimension on psychosocial risk is also a factor that needs to be further researched. And there is indeed evidence that the risks, psychosocial risk in women and in men are definitely different. It's not the same how women, what are the adverse effects in women by the biological and physiological characteristics than in men. So this is one aspect that needs to be still researched and put into evidence as well in the workplace and in the academy. So this is one point. The second point is that the nurses' case it's very difficult, and it's a very good example of what is a real workplace where stress is under pressure. What safety reps do need to do is indeed take the actions to go to the labor inspectorate, go ahead and talk to the preventive services. And this is the way that when the labor inspector needs to know what to do, and you can help them a lot. This is one of the aspects that have been working very well in other countries, where labor inspector can take the knowledge out from the safety reps and then act and do something more concretely and a more specific intervention at the workplace.
Thank you. Somebody else would like to add something? Sergio.
I think beside the specific case that was mentioned, the healthcare sector is particularly critical. Many of the national surveys are showing that the perception of stress at work is in the highest sector. That, for instance, is the case of our national survey. But particularly, I think the case of the nursing is one of that example where you need a structural intervention. What has been done for the shortage of the nursing and the early retirement, early exit from labor market of the nursing and the shortage that there is on the nursing is very much related to management of the psychosocial risk factor. So that's one of the cases of sustainability of welfare system and efficiency of healthcare system goes through good work organization.
Yes, absolutely. It is important to not only to look at high-risk populations such as nursing, but also to look more general at the gender difference. And it is not easy to summarize the evidence on gender-specific work stress and health associations, because on the one hand, you have the double burden in many women with a doubling of risk with private family relations and work-related issues. And then you also often have the problem of discrimination or of inequality, at least, of unfair payments of women and unfair career opportunities. On the other hand, the picture concerning health impact is a little bit mixed, because why is this the case? Because the exposure time among women is usually shorter than among men. And if you are interested in the long-term effects of work exposure to health, then you see that women often have interruptions in their work careers, or they work part-time. So that's why probably the long-term effects have been demonstrated more clearly among men. But this does not mean that the health effects of work are minor among women. It's rather this lack of exposure evidence which is there.
Okay, thank you. And last question.
Yeah, good morning. First, I'd like to thank the presentation from Professor Johannes Siegrist, because it was very good presentation, and mainly in the end, because I think all presentations should end with some costs analysis that you said about it, and I think it's very important. And Kris, I'm going to be very mean to you. I'm going to tell you that you killed a known song that world makes the world money makes the world go around. You know this song, yeah? Money makes the world go around. So, if the trigger it's not money, what do you think that we should? What kind of triggers that we should have besides this kind of triggers that you listen from Spain, from the. So now I'm not sure. That's what kind of triggers that we should use, because at this moment Europe, its economy, costs, numbers. So what is the next way of pulling the trigger? Thank you.
Yesterday in my opening statement, when I was explaining my business case, which I should not do, but I did not once mention the word stress there. I said, what do our companies want? They want a productive workforce that is engaged, that does not disengage, that does not drop out of work. And they want, so if you want that, you want to be successful as a company, you can only be successful if your workforce is productive and engaged. You can be successful at the short term with a not so productive workforce with a lot of pressure, but in the long term, if you want a sustainable company, you want to be successful, and a lot of businesses operate, unlike what we think, operate not in a global environment. Most of our businesses operate in a local environment, and there are also people that live in a village and they want to be seen as social entrepreneurs. So most of them, they care about their workforce. So you want them to be productive, and in order for that engaged, productive workforce, you have to create the working conditions in which they can thrive. And that is the trigger. That's a business story. And I've not once used the word health and stress. But of course, if I start to take action to create this work environment, to look at the working conditions, look at the individual aspirations, men and women, very right, have different aspirations, we have to take that into account. So as soon as we start to take action to create this work environment, look at working conditions, look at job content, look at the development possibilities for competency development, look into all that, we are creating this environment. So the trigger, that is for me the trigger, without using even the word stress, health, absenteeism, etc. That is what I would suggest as a business case. And if I may give one advice before you start deploying any program, look into the trust respect thing. And you say, okay, this is a soft value. No, there is methodologies, and I all encourage you to read The Speed of Trust by Covey. He translated the whole concept of trust and respect in a methodology with 13 behaviors. If you start with that, you will already advance a lot. Because of a lot of the issues, without really saying it's the working time or it's the workload, by developing this trust, respect culture, you already solve a lot of problems. And then you start with your programs, looking into the actual job content, looking into the actual working conditions, etc. So explore that. And I know there are companies
I visited one in Germany that said it was a German company, a lot of procedures, everything in order, risk is everything. But they hit a ceiling. They were not able to advance further, not able to improve their health and safety performance any further. So what did they do? They put respect on top of any procedure, but respect with some rules of the game, as I explained, the methodology, on top of every procedure. And that enabled them to break through the ceiling and further improve their performance.
Thank you.
Maybe I can help you a little bit because I agree with you, of course, but where I'm working in a big company, and as you know, business case at the end is necessary to get the money. You have to do it. And my suggestion is everything that you are or you invest in health, in prevention, is always a good business, always. You have to find the way to explain it to the guys of the money, if you find it. And we have many, many studies or many things that we can show that's an evidence, then they you will convince them and you get the money. That's what we do. Because yes, of course, there are other things very important, but we need the money to do it.
Finding the right words to convince them. Is your question very short? Yes, go on, last one.
In fact, it's not a question. It was really on this debate that scientific data are absolutely necessary, otherwise nothing will never happen. But my experience is to put health and human as a first place is not based on scientific data nor business case. It is a value-based decision. This is a problem. This is a value-based long-term decision instead of immediate short-term other values that cannot be linked to health. Okay. So for me, the consequences that are demonstrated also by scientific studies that putting money on health is leading to a good effect on performance. Yes, all the decision makers know that, but to go into that direction is also based on their own values, and this is difficult. And it's not enough to have business case for me, in my experience. And so we have to think. When we think or to put research evidence into practice, I think we have to have some reflection on this kind of value-based decision.
Thank you. Okay, so I would like to end by asking, would you like to say something? Yeah. You? No. No, okay. I would like to end by asking two questions to the whole panel. The first one is very specifically, so when it comes to managing stress at work, what is, according to you, still necessary, like the main thing that's very necessary, like in two sentences, Kris? Respect.
Yeah. I already gave my answer, I think, so okay. I've talked enough. I will pass the mic to...
Okay, good. Aïda.
Yeah, well, in two sentences, I would say design the working environment healthy from the beginning, which is basically applying safety by design, which is very common in the chemical industry, where industries can find substitutes to hazardous substances and have a healthier and safer environment. Well, the risk is the same. Eliminate the risk and apply the healthy by design environment always from the very beginning of the elaboration of the business case.
Thank you.
I think many of the statements about how to approach awareness and to promote action can be summarized in the aim to develop participatory approaches within companies and to give voice to the workers, but also to include expertise from the occupational health safety professionals and from the management. And as I said, there's also need to inform management and to challenge management for the issue. So participatory approaches are important. And otherwise, reduce the science policy gap. We have shown how healthy work looks like. We have the evidence. But to transform this evidence into contexts, into working programs at the company level. there's still a gap, and that needs to be reduced by all means.
Thank you.
Well, I think that really not all the companies, not all the workplaces are the same. So the most important thing is to have the correct information that what are your problems, and then focus your resources in solving your problems, no? Using, of course, all the resources that you have. That's the main point.
Thank you. Sergio?
Well, I think what was mentioned is the participatory approach, which I fully agree is the key, but also translating evidence base in something everybody can handle and manage in their language and in their daily use. And the third element is the make them believe they can make it, they can make a difference. I think these are the three key elements to make a successful story.
Pam?
I think within organisations, but also on a wider scale, we need to start realising that it's just not acceptable. The nurse's example is perfect in that people are saying, that's the job, that's what you've got to put up with. I think that has to change. And if that has to change within an organisation, it has to be an end-to-end culture. So one of my experiences was somebody on a course who said, I could do all these techniques, I could make sure I have lunch and go home on time, but I know my manager really wants me to stay late. And I said, how do you know that? And they said, because he stays late. So we have to role model. You have to go home on time, you have to take your lunch break, you have to show people that you really do mean that well-being is important.
And I'll start again with you, so because I'm there now. What is your personal tip to do so, but your personal tip as in to be put into practice in the workplace? What is your key tip?
Okay, my key tip is actually outside of the workplace,
okay.
But it's about cake and it's about wine, so it's an interesting point. And it's that thing about self-medication, that when we get stressed, we often head for the fridge or, you know, whatever our self-medication is. So it's important, and it's something that I've found useful, is to put a bridge between stress and the fridge. So breathe, yoga, music, just lie on the floor, scream, do whatever you need to do to just make a gap so you don't
just
kind
don't
of
open
make
that
things
fridge,
worse. Basically. Don't open the fridge. Or you can open it later when you're in a better frame of mind to make a good decision.
Good. Sergio, your top tip.
Top tip is to convince that the first real approach is to make an interventional approach. I mean, the coping strategies and the personal, individual, interpersonal intervention are important as well as a part of engagement, but the key point that this has to be structural. It's an organizational intervention.
Thank you. Patricia?
Well, I think that the important thing is to be always positive and find the problems and look for the solutions. Be optimistic that working, we can achieve the success.
Thank you.
Can you give me the privilege to be the last?
Yes, I would have liked to be the last. But okay, last but one then. Yes.
Okay, from my side, I would say identify, avoid and prevent, identify the risks, avoid them at all costs and prevent them as well at all costs. Again, from the beginning.
For me, that would be self-reflection. Look into yourself. If you know you're doing your best, you're doing what you can more easily cope with stress, because then you can prioritize. You know, I do my best. There is nothing more I can do, so I can let go of other things. But at the same time, also take some time now and then for honest self-reflection, because we all think we are doing our best and we're doing what we can, but if you're really honest and look into yourself, then you know it's not always true. Let's face it, it's not always true. So also ask yourself now and then, is this really my job? Is this really what I want to do? Do I want to work for this leader? Do I want to work in this hospital? Is this what I see for myself, the rest of my working life? Is this my future? Take some time for self-reflection. And even if the answer is, no, I don't want to work here anymore, still find then some ways to make it easier to cope with it until you maybe get an opportunity
to find another job.
Okay, so I'll go first, you get the honor. Huh? I would say one word, fish, and some people here in the room know what I mean by fish. It's not the ones that swim. But has anybody heard of the parable of the porpoise? You can Google it. Just for those who don't know porpoise, I didn't know it the first time. A porpoise is a type of dolphin, okay? And basically it's about recognition, positive recognition. We've seen it's very, very important. It comes originally from Gregory Bateson. It's this story. I have it on the website if you want it. And it's giving positive feedback to people. It's not done enough. We've seen it's very important. Recognition is important. It's important at all levels, personal level, interpersonal, structural. Start spreading fish. That's my message.
Well, first I want to thank all those who contributed to this really interesting discussion. And I assume that the majority of the audience here are people involved in business at the company level, more probably. However, we are here invited by a European agency, which is the EU-OSHA. And actually, I think we should widen the frame of reference beyond looking at companies, as important as they are, but we should look really at the broader level of political decision making and the political processes, because, as I've shown, we have huge differences in the quality of work and also in the health conditions of employers between Eastern, Western, Northern, Southern European countries. This is unfair. We should have less inequalities. We have huge inequalities within each country between the highly qualified academic people and the unskilled or low-skilled people at the bottom. We can do something to reduce inequalities between and within countries. And so we need to extend the frame beyond the company level, as important as it is, and we should address the political frame to help reducing these inequalities and promoting healthy work for all.
Thank you very much. Now you go and spread the word. So this is now time for the coffee, 30 minutes, and then you're expected back in. Thank you very much.